Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Evil Never Sleeps by William W. Johnstone with J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by Eric Michael Summerer. Chapter 1.
Good morning, Will.
Daniel Stone, U.S. Marshal for the Western District of Arkansas, greeted his deputy cordially when Will Tanner walked into his office over the jail.
Have you been taking a little time to rest up since you brought Ben Wheeler in from Muskogee?
Will was immediately suspicious. As a rule, Dan Stone was businesslike and took little time for idle conversation. He had a feeling he was about to be given an assignment he didn't particularly want. I reckon, he answered. Doing a few chores that needed doing. Figured I'd have to hang around for Wheeler's trial.
I doubt they're going to need any testimony from you, Stone said. There were enough witnesses that saw him shoot those two fellows.
He shook his head.
No, Judge Parker won't need to tie you up for that trial.
Here it comes, Will thought. Stone continued.
I know you just got back from a long trip, but I also know how you hate sitting around with nothing to do. So I've got the very assignment you need.
I kind of figured you might, Will responded.
It ain't nothing bad, Stone quickly insisted. It's an easy job, matter of fact. Just transport a prisoner down to Texas and turn him over to the Texas Rangers. That's all.
Who's the prisoner? Will asked.
Billy Cotton.
Billy Cotton? Will questioned.
That's the young boy Alvin Greeley brought back with those other two outlaws, ain't it? Why are you turning him over to the Rangers? The three of them robbed the store in McAllister, didn't they? Well, not really, Stone answered. It turns out that Billy Cotton just happened to be drinking with the two who'd done the robbery when Alvin arrested him. Come to find out, Billy was telling the truth when he said he wasn't with him when they damn near killed that fellow that owned the store.
He wasn't, Will replied. Then why don't they just cut him loose and let him go home?
Like I said, the Texas Rangers have a warrant out for him, so we agreed to turn him over. He wasn't guilty of anything in Oklahoma, but he'd been up to something in Texas, I reckon.
Seems to me Greeley would be the one to take him back, since he was the one who arrested him, Will said. Stone was well aware of the friction between Will and Alvin because of a case they had worked together when Will was still fairly new to the job.
Ah, hell, Will. I know what you're thinking. To tell you the truth, I think Alvin was pretty rough on the boy, so I'd appreciate it if you'd take him back to Texas. I thought you might take advantage of the trip to check on your ranch down there. I know it's been a while since you have. We can have the Rangers pick him up in Sulphur Springs. That's a short ride from that ranch of yours, ain't it? I'll wire him when you go, and they can meet you there. Now that's a handy arrangement, mixing business with pleasure, and I'll pay your usual mileage down there. What do you say?
But no mileage for the trip back, Will stated.
No, Stone said. Because you won't be transporting a prisoner on the way back.
All right, I'll take him. First thing in the morning.
Good, Stone said. And before you start back, wire me, in case there's some business down in that part of the nations that needs taken care of.
He grinned.
You might get your mileage paid for the ride back home, if there is.
Will had a few things to do to get ready to leave in the morning. Foremost on the list was to get new shoes on Buster and the bay packhorse. While that was being done, he decided to back up his supplies for the 3-day ride down to Texas with enough food to feed his prisoner and himself. Cartridges for his Winchester were getting low also, so he would take care of that too. And coffee. He could do without all the other things, even the cartridges, but he had to have an ample supply of coffee. After leaving the supplies he bought in the small storeroom he rented at Vern Tuttle's stable, he walked over to the blacksmith to pick up his horses and return to the stable with them.
I ain't sure how early I'll be here in the morning to saddle up, he told Vern. Depends on when they turn that prisoner over to me.
Well, you know I'm always here early, Vern assured him. If I ain't, that feller's horse is that sorrel yonder in the back stall. His saddle's in the stall with him.
When all his preparations were completed, he stopped by the jail to let Sid Randolph know he was picking up a prisoner in the morning.
I heard, Sid informed him.
They already sent me the paperwork telling me to turn one Billy Cotton over to Deputy Marshal Will Tanner, he proclaimed grandly. Then he chuckled over his attempt to be clever.
What time you want him, Will?
Will paused to consider that. He normally set out before breakfast, but maybe he should let his prisoner eat his breakfast before starting. He couldn't help thinking about also fortifying himself with a good breakfast from Ruth Bennett's table before starting out again. It was an easy decision.
I'll pick him up after he's had his breakfast, he said. See you in the morning.
His chores done, he decided to stop by the Morning Glory on his way back to Bennett House. It was still a little while before supper would be ready, and he decided he was in the mood for a drink of whiskey before he ate.
Well, howdy, stranger,
he was greeted by Gus Johnson when he walked in the door.
I heard you were back in town.
Gus was down at the end of the bar, talking to Dr. Peters. Will walked over to join them.
Howdy, Gus, Doc,
Will said, nodding to each in turn.
Just thought I'd stop by to see if you're still in business. Maybe I'm just in time to get a shot of the same medicine Doc's drinking there.
No matter what ails you, Doc said, a little drink of whiskey is the best thing I can prescribe.
He tossed it back and smacked his lips, contented. Doc's fondness for alcohol was well known, but it had no effect upon his practice. Most folks around Fort Smith felt he was more proficient at his profession drunk than sober.
I haven't had occasion to patch you up lately, Doc said when Gus moved down the bar to get a glass for Will. You're about due to get shot. It's been a while.
I reckon, Will replied.
He knew Doc was joking, but it struck a somber warning in his mind that he had paid no heed before. There was a sobering promise of tragedy awaiting all men who wore the deputy marshal's badge in Indian Territory. And the longer a man wore that badge, the more the odds went up against him. He thought of Fletcher Pride then, as he often did, and the vacuum in Ruth Bennett's life when he was killed.
It's the reason I don't walk back to the boarding house right now and tell her daughter Sophie I want to marry her, he thought.
He was suddenly startled when he realized it was the first time he had confessed it, even to himself. He glanced at Doc, aware that Doc was giving him a questioning look.
I'll try to see if I can give you more business from now on so you can pay your liquor bill, he said, and tossed his drink back. How about some service to your other customers?
Alvin Greeley yelled from a table in the back corner of the room.
I need some more of that sorry coffee you sell.
Will had noticed the other deputy when he came in, but had chosen to ignore him. Greeley was not a regular customer at the Morning Glory, so he had not expected to see him there. He was eating supper with Lucy Tyler sitting at the table with him, probably because there was no one else to pass the time with. She had just gotten up from her chair, heading toward the bar, when Greeley called after her.
What's the matter, Lucy? Ain't my company good enough for you? Hush up, Alvin,
she called back to him.
I need a drink, and it don't look like you're going to spring for it.
She moved up beside Will.
You want to buy me a drink?
Why, it'd be my pleasure, he said, and nodded to Gus to pour it.
That man will talk a body to death, she complained. I figured that if I didn't get up from there pretty soon, I was going to go crazy.
She tossed her drink back, then placed her hand on Will's forearm.
When are you going to marry me and take me out of this place?
Will laughed.
Well, no time soon, I reckon. I've got to take a prisoner down to Texas in the morning, so it won't be for a while. If you're leaving town in the morning, it might make your ride go better if you stay with me tonight. I'd give you a special rate.
I swear that's mighty tempting, he said, stroking his chin and pretending to consider her offer. But I've still got some things to take care of before I go, so maybe some other time.
Fiddle, she scoffed. You say that every time. I think you're true loving some gal. Maybe that little girl at the boarding house.
I promise you that ain't the case, he said, and was about to say more to placate her when Alvin Greeley could hold his tongue no longer. Will was sorry to see him push his angular body up from his chair and walk toward them, slumped over to one side, favoring a shoulder smashed by a bullet wound that had never healed properly. In Will's first year, he had worked one job with Greeley and found that he just couldn't get along with him. He had decided to simply forget about it and do his best to avoid the man. But for some reason, Greeley had let the incident fester inside him until he developed a deep resentment toward the young deputy. After that first time, Will had worked mostly alone, and on several cases when he was forced to kill or be killed, Greeley had seen that as an opportunity to put the young deputy in a bad light. So he complained to Dan Stone, and everyone who would listen, that Will was too quick to shoot and would always prefer to kill rather than capture. Greeley fancied himself the senior deputy, now that Fletcher Pride was gone, and he seemed to think he deserved respect from the junior deputies. Had Will known Greeley was in the saloon on this night, he would not have stopped in. Greeley's usual hangout was the Smith House saloon. He had a room there, so Will hadn't expected to run into him in the morning glory.
"Dan Stone told me you was going to transport Billy Cotton back down to Little Dixie," Greeley said.
"That's right," Will answered.
"Billy Cotton was my prisoner. I captured him, along with them other two buzzards. I told Dan I'd take him back down there when we're done with the trial. It ought to be my responsibility to transport him back to turn him over to the Rangers. I reckon Dan figured it'd be a nice, easy little trip for you to pick up some mileage money."
"If you got a problem, Greeley, it ain't with me. It's with Dan. I didn't ask for the job, so you're wasting your time complaining to me about it." Greeley was obviously disappointed in Will's reluctance to argue with him, so he goaded him on.
"That boy ain't really such a bad one. He got his back up a little couple of times, but I straightened him out. I'm just worried that he won't make it as far as the Poteau River before he gets a bullet in the back of his head."
"What do you mean by that?" Will demanded, knowing what he was referring to and not willing to let that pass.
"You know what I mean. Everybody knows you bring in more bodies than live prisoners," Greeley charged. "That ain't no secret."
Will caught himself just before calling Greeley a liar. It was a lie, and nobody but Greeley believed Will was too quick on the trigger. It wouldn't do for two deputy marshals to have it out in a saloon, however, and he was afraid if he called Greeley a liar, it would force him to fight. It was best to just walk away, so that's what he did. "Here's for the drinks," he said to Gus. "I expect I'd best get on home." He turned and started toward the door. He had almost reached it when he heard the scream.
"Will!"
Without thinking, he spun around and dropped to a crouch, just in time to avoid the pistol swung like a club at his head. He came up from his crouch with a hard right hand to Greeley's gut, doubling him over with pain. Greeley sank to his knees, holding his stomach with both arms wrapped around himself. It was only a moment before the contents of his stomach came up to deposit Mammy's fine supper on the saloon floor. Will watched him for a moment to make sure he wasn't going to get up again before looking at Lucy and nodding his thanks. He left then, feeling a little sick inside himself for the disgrace Greeley had brought to them both.
"I'll be leaving in the morning. Be gone for a week or more," Will told Ruth Bennett when he walked in the dining room for supper.
"Oh?" Ruth replied. "I hope it's not something dangerous."
"No, ma'am. I'm just going to transport a prisoner down to Texas. But it's right close to my ranch in Sulphur Springs, so I'll most likely stay over a couple of days just to see how things are going at the J-Bar J."
"Well," she said, smiling at him, "maybe that will be like a little vacation for you. I mean, after you turn the prisoner over. I think it might be a good occasion to give your room a real cleaning. It's about due."
In the kitchen, Sophie paused to listen to the conversation between Will and her mother. She picked up a platter of pork chops and carried it into the dining room.
"So you're going to be gone again,"
she said to Will as she placed the platter down before Leonard Dickens, one of the older boarders.
"You just got back. Looks like Dan Stone would give you time to catch your breath before sending you back out again."
Will shrugged, not knowing exactly how best to answer.
"It's the nature of the business, I reckon. Dan had something he needed to have done, and I'm the only one handy right now. Like I told your mama, it's a good chance to visit the ranch. It's been a while since I've been there, and Shorty kind of likes to have me check with him now and then.
More than a little interested in the conversation between the two, Ruth had to ask,
"Do you ever have any plans to give up the marshalling business and go back to the ranch?"
Will hesitated a moment.
"I don't know, but I've been thinking about it a lot more lately."
He made sure he didn't glance at Sophie when he said it. Ruth looked at once at her daughter to see the faint smile on Sophie's face. She said nothing, but she wanted to warn her.
"Don't you go getting your hopes up, young lady. Getting him to settle down on a ranch would be like telling a hawk not to fly anymore."
Sometimes it was all she could do to keep from screaming at her daughter in a desperate plea to stop her from traveling the same road she had. She looked at Will.
"Are you going to be here for breakfast in the morning?"
"Yes, ma'am," he said. "I reckon I'll most likely be the first one at the table. I want to get an early start, but I don't want to miss breakfast here."
He told himself that it would take some time to transfer the prisoner into his custody anyway, so he might as well settle for a late start. After supper, he went out on the porch while the women cleaned up the dishes to sit and talk with Leonard Dickens and Ron Sample, who had been living at the boarding house long before Will came. They were the eldest of Ruth's boarders, and they usually sat on the porch after supper to light up their pipes and discuss the news of the day. Will often wondered how they could have any news to discuss, since it seemed they never left the boarding house.
"Ain't gonna be many more nights before it'll be right nippy setting out here on the porch," Leonard commented.
"I expect so," Ron agreed. "Then it'll be back to the parlor till spring."
Directing his question at Will, he asked,
"Gets pretty cold sleeping out on the prairie, don't it?"
When Will confirmed that it did, Ron went on.
"You start putting some years on you and it'll get a damn sight harder to keep warm. You need you a good woman to keep you warm, and you ain't likely to find one as long as you're riding all over Injun territory looking for outlaws. Ain't that right, Leonard?"
"That's right," Leonard said. "And I expect he knows it. You can tell that by the way he looks at Sophie every time he thinks she ain't looking at him."
"You must be smoking loco weed in that pipe," Will said with a dismissive chuckle.
But the comment gave him reason to be concerned. Had he been that obvious?
"Some lucky young man is bound to tie that little gal up before much longer," Ron said. "Garth Pearson thought he had her lassoed, but she's got too much spirit for him. You'd best step up there, if you're of a mind to. She ain't likely to wait much longer."
"What are you telling me all this for?" Will responded. "That's Sophie's business."
At that moment, the front door opened and Sophie came out.
"What's Sophie's business?" she asked.
No one answered, so she asked again.
"What's Sophie's business?"
She looked directly at Will for an answer.
"Setting up the coffee pot in the morning,"
Will came back with the only thing he could think of.
"I was just saying I'd like to get an early start in the morning, and I might have to get by on nothing but coffee."
Sophie was not satisfied that he had answered her honestly, especially when it was accompanied by snickers from the two older men. Fortunately for Will, the evening light had faded enough to hide the sudden blush that had come to his face.
"Well, I reckon I'm going to turn in," he said. "I've got a long ride to Texas in the morning."
He stepped quickly to the door and went inside. Sid Randolph met Will by the side door of the jail. Standing behind him, another guard was holding the prisoner by the manacles, locking his hands behind his back.
"Morning, Will," Sid greeted him. "Looks like you're ready to ride. I've got your boy here, Mr. Billy Cotton."
He handed Will a paper with the order and authorization by Judge Isaac Parker.
"I see you ain't got no jail wagon. Dan Stone said you wouldn't have one. You want me to unlock his wrists?"
"Yep," Will answered.
"Unlock him, then lock him again in front of him.
No sense in making him ride all the way to Texas with his hands behind his back. According to this paper here, I'm authorized to shoot him at the first sign of trouble."
The remark was meant to give the prisoner something to think about, even though the paper he held said nothing of the kind. He took a long moment to study his prisoner while the guard handcuffed him again. Billy Cotton looked even younger than Dan Stone had described. He said he was 18, but he looked no more than 15 or 16. He stood there, patiently waiting for the cuffs to be locked, his head down, with no effort to make eye contact with Will. Will remembered that Stone had remarked that he thought Alvin Greeley might have been a little rough on the boy, and it occurred to him that Stone's remark could very well be an understatement. Looking still closer, Will asked Sid, "Was he wearing those bruises around his eyes when Greeley brought him in, or did he get him here?"
"He had them when we got him," Sid answered. "My guards don't use any force on our prisoners unless they start it."
He paused to look at Billy.
"And he ain't done nothing but sit in a corner of the cell room since he got here. Ain't said more'n two or three words the whole time."
Will took a long look at his prisoner before introducing himself.
"I don't know if they told you or not, but my name's Will Tanner, and it's my job to take you down to Sulphur Springs in Texas. It won't be a hard ride if you've got your mind in the right place. You don't give me any trouble, and I won't give you a hard time. If you try to escape, I won't hesitate to use my rifle to slow you down. Do we understand each other?"
"Yes, sir," Billy replied. "I won't cause you no trouble."
The young man's respectful, even gentle nature aroused Will's curiosity. He didn't seem at all like the typical young hellion that aspired to operate on the wrong side of the law. "What kind of warrants are out for you in Texas?"
"Somebody saw me riding with some of my cousins," Billy said.
"Is that against the law in Texas?" Will asked with only a hint of sarcasm.
"No, sir, but most folks around Red River County know that the Cottons and the Treadwells are cattle rustlers, so I reckon they figured I was a rustler too."
"Are you saying you're not?" Will asked.
"No, sir. I mean, yes, sir. I'm saying I'm not."
"When Deputy Greeley caught up with those two men down near the Mountain Fork River, you were with them, right? So you were riding with them up in Choctaw country."
Will was still trying to pin him down.
"No, sir," Billy replied. "I rode up to Buford Ramsey's store at Little River to see his daughter, Sarah. She works in her daddy's store and told me to come back to see her one time when I was there before. I went back to see her again and we sort of hit it off. I sure as shooting didn't expect to run into Joe and Barney there. Those two men are my cousins, Joe Treadwell and Barney Treadwell. They tried to tell that deputy I wasn't with him when they robbed that store up in McAllister. They just happened to show up at that trading post when I was there. Didn't have no idea they'd run into me. We tried to tell the deputy, but he said he knew better than that. After we got to Fort Smith was when he found out I wasn't lying."
Will listened patiently and found himself believing the young man was simply the victim of some mighty bad luck.
"How'd you get those bruises around your eyes?"
"I didn't sit down quick enough," Billy replied. "That deputy told me to sit down on the ground while he unlocked the leg chains. I didn't understand what he said, so I didn't move quick enough, I reckon. He whacked me with the barrel of his rifle a couple of times."
To Will, that sounded typical of Alvin Greeley. Victims of his arrests often showed up in court with cuts and bruises. Will found it ironic that, in view of this, Greeley seemed to constantly campaign to paint him as a lawman who preferred to put a bullet in the back of a man's head than go to the trouble of bringing him in alive. It was a reputation he did not deserve, and certainly one he didn't want.
"Well," he decided, "step up in that saddle and we'll get started."
They rode off toward the river, headed for Indian territory, Will leading with Billy's reins tied to his saddle, and his pack horse following behind on a lead rope. Billy seemed to be content sitting in his saddle. Will figured it was a far sight better than the hard bench of the jail wagon he had made the trip to Fort Smith in. Will figured he was not being too careless when he discounted the possibility of any trouble from the mild young man. He figured it close to 100 miles to that trading post on the Little River, down in the area known as Little Dixie. It was a small section of Oklahoma near the borders of Texas and Arkansas that had gotten its name because of the number of Southern sympathizers that moved there after the Civil War. He had an idea that it might be worthwhile to stop there on his way to Texas to hear what folks there said about the arrests of the two Treadwell boys and Billy. It was a good day to ride. Dog days of summer brought some unexpected pleasant days with nights chilly enough to remind folks that winter was not that far away. Will decided to follow the Poto River Trail south, once they crossed over into Indian territory, planning to rest the horses at a favorite spot about 25 miles from Fort Smith. Because of their late start, it was past noon when Will turned Buster down a path that led through the trees that lined the riverbank. After they dismounted, Will handcuffed Billy's hands around a small tree while he took care of the horses and built a fire. "You like coffee?" he asked Billy while he was filling the small coffee pot he always carried.
"Yes, sir," Billy replied respectfully.
"Well, we'll have us a cup while the horses are resting," Will said. When the coffee was ready, he walked over and unlocked the manacles. "It'll be a hell of a lot easier to drink your coffee if your hands ain't wrapped around a tree." He was going on a gut feeling that the young man offered no threat of violence, nor an attempt to escape. Even so, he would keep a sharp eye on him in case he was wrong and had to take action in a hurry. Once Billy was settled on the bank, Will handed him his cup.
"Much obliged," Billy said.
Convinced that the young man had been honest when he said he had never stolen any cattle, Will purposely tried to engage him in idle conversation. It wasn't long before Billy was talking freely, and the longer they talked, the more convinced Will became of Billy's innocence. He told Will about his desire to marry Buford Ramsey's daughter, Sarah, and work his own small farm in Little Dixie. She had already said she would marry him, and that was after only his second visit.
"I reckon it was one of those love-at-first-sight things," Billy said. "We were both ready to get married right away."
It was just bad luck that his cousins had shown up when they did, bringing Alvin Greeley right behind them.
"I just want to get back to Sarah so we can start our life together," Billy said.
Finally, Will decided it was time to get started again. Billy got to his feet and dutifully extended his wrists for the manacles. Will hesitated, wondering if he should trust his gut feelings that Billy didn't have an evil bone in his body.
"I'll tell you what I'm going to do," he said. "I'm bound to deliver you to the Texas Rangers in Sulphur Springs. I believe you when you say you ain't guilty of any crime, and I'll do my best to convince the Rangers that they ain't got no reason to hold you. That's about the best I can do for you."
He didn't tell him that he was thinking over the possibility of letting him escape before they reached the Red River. The only reason he probably wouldn't was because that would brand Billy as a definite fugitive from justice.
"I surely do thank you, sir,"
Billy said, showing genuine excitement for the first time.
"I knew you were a good man right off."
He was so excited, he fairly leaped into the saddle, anxious to get started. Will had trouble keeping the grin off his own face as he led out through the trees that bordered the river. Thinking about it later, he thought he might have heard the impact of the bullet when it struck Billy, a fraction of a second before he heard the report of the rifle that fired it. With no time to think, his natural reactions had taken over, and he wheeled Buster around a stand of oak trees, seeking cover from the shooter. He yanked hard on Billy's reins to bring the horse behind the trees with him. At that moment, he didn't know that Billy was hit, and he drew his rifle as he jumped out of the saddle to help him dismount. When he reached up to grab his arm, Billy collapsed sideways to land heavily on him. Since he was holding his rifle in one hand, he had only one arm to catch Billy, causing him to stagger backward before regaining his balance. Only then did he discover the bullet hole in the young man's shirt, right between his shoulder blades. As quickly as he could manage, he laid Billy down behind the largest of the oaks. Then he crawled toward the edge of the trees, trying to see where the attack had come from. The only place that afforded a shooter a spot to hide was a wooded ridge about 75 yards from the river. So he cranked a cartridge into the magazine and held his Winchester ready to fire at the first sight of a muzzle flash from the next shot. But there was no second shot. Still, he waited as the seconds ticked slowly by until the minutes began to pile up. When there were still no more shots, he had to figure the sniper was lying in wait for another target to show himself. "Waiting for me to come out in the open," he thought. He had to see how badly Billy was hit, but he was reluctant to take his eyes off the ridge when there was a chance the bushwhacker might move to a new spot himself. After another wait of about 10 minutes, with all still quiet, he decided he had to act.
Chapter 2. "I can't sit here in the bushes all day," he thought, and started scanning the open ground between him and the ridge.
Several mounds caught his eye as possible points of cover, and he thought that maybe he could advance on that ridge by running from one mound to the next.
"Not a chance in hell," he counseled himself,
but he considered himself a fair runner. So before he could talk himself out of it, he sprang to his feet and took off as fast as he could run for the first mound. Only after he slid to a clumsy stop behind the small swale of sand did he speculate that he should have taken his boots off. The high heels weren't meant for running. Surprised that their bushwhacker had not taken a shot at him, he peeked over the top of the mound. When there was no reaction from the ridge, he took a deep breath and ran to another mound, this one closer to the row of laurels at the foot of the ridge. As before, there was no shot. He dived behind the second mound and paused there until his breathing slowed down again. He found it hard to believe the sniper took that one shot, then left. Who was he? Likely some relative of an outlaw he had arrested, seeking revenge for his hanging. Will wondered if the shooter realized he had shot Billy and not him. Probably not, and thinking he had gotten the man he came after, he rode away. But Will had to make sure the sniper was gone. With one last dash to gain the cover of the laurel, he took off, and again there was no shot. By this time he was convinced that the assassin had run, so he kept going, climbing the ridge to the top to find no one there. A quick look around turned up a footprint that led him to the spot where the rifleman had lain. Will looked back toward the oak trees beside the river as the shooter would have seen them. It was a clear target area, and in Will's opinion, open enough to have given the shooter time for a second shot, had he wanted it. "You shot the wrong man," he thought, still finding it hard to believe the assassin didn't take the second shot. Half a dozen yards down the back side of the ridge, Will found the spot where the shooter had left his horse, and tracks down the slope told him he had hurried down the back of the ridge in a direction that would lead him to the trail north toward Fort Smith. His thought was to go after him, but first he had to go back to help Billy, so he hurried back down the ridge toward the trees where he had left him. Billy was lying right where he had left him, never having moved or shifted his body. Will guessed his prisoner was dead, even before he knelt beside him. There was no response to his efforts to revive him, and the blank gaze of his open eyes confirmed there was no life left in the body. A little wave of sorrow swept over Will for a moment. In the short time he had been exposed to Billy Cotton, he had come to the opinion that the guileless young man was no more than an innocent bystander and was probably guilty of no crime. And now to die because he had been mistaken for him was really hard luck. "I reckon that cancels the trip to Texas," he said aloud. The decision to be made now was whether to bury Billy or take him back to Fort Smith. And that led to the question of the shooter. He preferred not to waste any more time before going after him, not sure he wouldn't make another attempt if he found out he had shot the prisoner and not the deputy. Another thought struck him then, one that seemed too twisted to consider, but could not be discounted right away. What if the shooter had not killed the wrong man? What if he was so sure he had shot the man he came after that he saw no need for a second shot? Who would stand to gain by the killing? The first answer that came to mind was Alvin Greeley. It was outrageous to think a man would go to that extent, but if Will returned Billy Cotton's body to Fort Smith with a bullet in his back, Greeley would tell the world, "I told you so." It would go a long way in justifying his claims that Will killed for the convenience of not having to transport prisoners.
It was still hard for Will to believe that even Greeley was not above such a murderous act. On the other hand, Greeley might have been shamed enough by the incident between them in the Morning Glory to seek revenge. And it might seem better to Greeley to see Will saddled with the reputation of a cowardly backshooter. He thought of the satisfaction Greeley would enjoy if Dan Stone would demand Will's badge. It made more sense the more he thought about it. Greeley might like to see him dead, but he wanted him disgraced more, and that's why he didn't take that second shot. His mind made up, he stood Billy's body up and got his shoulder under it, then he lifted it and settled it across the saddle. He took pains to tie it on firmly before it got too stiff to bend, knowing that he needed to start after the bushwhacker as soon as possible, and he felt he was getting farther and farther behind every minute. Deciding his horses were ready to travel, he stepped up into the saddle. If he could pick up the shooter's trail, he might be able to catch up with him. If not right away, then maybe when he camped for the night. At the backside of the ridge, he found tracks coming down the slope, and they clearly headed toward the wagon trail he had followed from Fort Smith. Upon reaching the trail, he dismounted to study the fresh tracks that led onto it. Even though there were traces of other travelers on the road, his own tracks among them, he found that the freshest tracks led toward Fort Smith. They had to be those of the sniper, so he headed back to the city. About halfway back to Fort Smith, he reached a point where he wanted to make sure of his chase. At a shallow bend in the Poteau, an old Indian trail forked off to the west. If the man he followed did not intend to ride on to Fort Smith and chose to ride west into Indian territory instead, he would likely take the Indian trail to avoid having to ford the Arkansas River. He dismounted and made a careful search of the ground beside the road. The light was beginning to fade away to evening, but there was still enough to examine any tracks he found veering from the wagon road. He found none that were new enough to be the man he followed, and after a few minutes he mumbled, "The son of a bitch is headed to Fort Smith." No longer concerned with finding tracks, he stepped back up into the saddle and headed Buster straight toward Fort Smith. He had no proof that Alvin Greeley was the sniper who put a bullet in Billy Cotton's back, but he felt that was the case without doubt. While it was debatable whether Greeley had intended to kill Billy, just the bullet hole in his back would be enough to cause speculation about the truth behind Greeley's accusations. At this point, it was his word against Greeley's, and he had to make sure of his suspicions before he charged Greeley outright. The first thing he wanted to know was if anyone was sure that Greeley had been in town all day. If he was, it would be easy enough to prove. Someone would have seen him at the Smith House saloon, the stable, or maybe Dan Stone's office. One sighting by anyone during the day would be enough to prove Will's hunch wrong. He decided his first stop upon reaching Fort Smith would be Vern Tuttle's stable, since Greeley kept his horses there. This, even before taking Billy's body to the undertaker.
"Howdy, Will,"
Vern Tuttle sang out when Will pulled up in front of the stable.
"What are you doing back here? I thought you was on your way to Texas."
He looked past him at the body lying across the sorrel.
"Who's that?"
"That's Billy Cotton," Will answered as he wasted no time stepping down. "He's the young boy I was transporting down to Texas, but somebody shot him. Have you seen Alvin Greeley today?"
"Greeley?"
Vern responded.
"Yeah, matter of fact, he brought his horse in a while back, that gray he rides."
"Why?" "I was just wondering. Is it in the corral?"
"Yep,"
Vern replied, and walked around the front of the stable with him to the corral.
"Yonder,"
he said, pointing. He watched Will then, his curiosity aroused by the young deputy's interest in Greeley's horse. Will walked over to the side rail where the gray was standing, watching him approach. The horse was calm and peaceful, unlike his owner. Still studying Will's curious manner, Vern commented,
"He looked pretty much wore out when Greeley brought him in. Looked like he'd been rode hard. I gave him a portion of grain and watered him good."
He waited for an explanation, but when it didn't come, he asked,
"How come you're so interested in Alvin Greeley's horse?"
You ain't never had much use for him or his horse.
Still don't, Will said, not ready to make any accusations, but convinced more than ever that Greeley had shot Billy. The cold facts only proved that Greeley had ridden somewhere that day and returned with a tired horse. He could have gone anywhere. How the hell am I going to put him at that camping spot on the Poto? He knew he was going to face Greeley with the accusation, but for now, he figured he'd best take poor Billy Cotton to the undertaker. So he left his pack horse there and told Vern he'd be back to leave the other two horses later. Ed Kittredge was just before closing up for the day when he saw Will pull up at the front of his building.
5 minutes later and you'd have missed me, he said when Will walked in.
Who's the corpse?
Young fellow named Billy Cotton, Will answered.
Gunshot?
Yep, right between the shoulder blades.
You shoot him?
Nope.
He was in my custody when he got shot, though, so I reckon that makes him my responsibility.
Who did?
Can't say, Will replied. But I've got a pretty good idea who it looks like. I'll tell Dan Stone you've got the body. I'll see if I can still catch him in his office.
All right, Kittredge said. Give me a hand getting him down off that horse. Looks like rigor mortis has already started setting in.
Rigor mortis had indeed progressed from the organs into the limbs, rendering Billy bent and stiff. They lifted the awkward corpse up off the saddle and carried him inside where they laid him on a table.
He'll be all right till morning, Kittredge said. I'll straighten him out then. I'm going to supper now.
As he had told Kittredge he would, Will then rode over to the courthouse to see if Dan was still in his office. He very much wanted to give Dan his side of the story before Greeley started spouting his accusations. When he got to the courthouse, he hurried up the stairs over the jail to Stone's office to find the door still open. Dan came out the door preparing to lock it just as Will walked up.
Will!
Stone exclaimed, surprised.
What are you doing back here?
I brought Billy Cotton's body back, Will explained, capturing Stone's interest immediately. He then went on to tell Stone the whole story of Billy's assassination. He withheld his suspicions about who the sniper was, preferring to get his boss's reaction.
Damn!
Stone exclaimed upon hearing the story. Like Will, his first thought was that the shot that killed Billy was actually intended for Will.
I reckon it was your lucky day. Too bad about your prisoner, though. I reckon his luck ran out.
Satisfied that Stone had accepted the story, just as he had told it, Will then proceeded to investigate his theory on who the sniper might be.
What's Alvin Greeley doing today? Did you send him anywhere today?
Greeley?
Stone responded.
No, I didn't send him on any job today. He's most likely hanging around town somewhere, waiting for the trial on those two he brought in. Why?
I was just wondering.
He had intended to tell Stone why he thought Greeley was the sniper who shot Billy, but decided at that moment to hold back until he could find some means of proving the accusation. Seconds later, he found he was to have no choice, for Greeley suddenly appeared at the top of the stairs. Will and Stone turned to watch Greeley lumber heavily down the hallway toward them. It was obvious that he had been drinking.
Well, I see you're already back.
He fired at Will.
Another prisoner brought in with a bullet hole in his back, and this one's supposed to be innocent. By damn, I told you.
This he aimed at Dan Stone.
You should have sent me to take that poor boy back.
While Stone stood astonished by Greeley's ranting, Will saw it as an opportunity to let him tangle himself up in his story.
What the hell are you talking about, Greeley?
You know damn well what I'm talking about,
Greeley sputtered.
That boy, Billy Cotton, brought in, shot in the back, like all them others you were supposed to be bringing in for trial.
How'd you know I brought Billy in? Will asked. And how'd you know he was shot in the back?
Greeley paused a moment before answering.
Why, they was talking about it at Smith House, he said. Must have stuck a gun in his back when he wasn't looking. Couldn't have been nobody else that done it.
Will looked at Dan Stone. I rode straight into Vern Tuttle's stable. Then I took the body to Ed Kittredge right when he was going home for supper. He said he'd work on it in the morning because he was in a hurry to get home to supper. He looked back at Greeley. I didn't pass a soul on the street. How the hell could anybody know about the body? He turned back to Greeley. So how the hell did anybody in Smith House know about it this soon? Greeley sputtered drunkenly, obviously trying to think of a response. While Stone gaped, still astonished, Will made his accusation. There ain't but one person who knew I brought Billy Cotton back tonight, and that's the son of a bitch who shot him in the back. Kind of makes me wonder how you knew about it so soon. Where were you today, Greeley?
Why, you... Greeley started, then checked himself. I was right here all day, in my room at the saloon, catching up on my sleep. It ain't no business of yourn where I was.
He looked at Stone as if asking for help, but the marshal already saw where this was leading. In your room all day, Will repeated. Then how come you brought that gray of yours back to the stable this evening plumb near wore out, according to Vern Tuttle? Greeley couldn't answer right away. His alcohol-soaked brain was turning too slowly to think, and the look on Dan Stone's face gave him more cause for worry. He knew too late that he had tried to spring his trap too soon. He had been too anxious to shine the shadow of doubt on Will. Now he frantically tried to untangle the web he had caught himself in.
Wait a minute. I forgot about that feller that wanted to buy my horse. I told him he could take it for a ride. I reckon he must have run him half to death.
He searched Stone's face, trying to determine if he believed it. When it was obvious that he did not, Greeley reverted to his aggressive nature.
I don't like the way this is going. What the hell have you two been cooking up? Has he been telling you lies about me?
Greeley was working himself up into a rage that was plainly boosted by the whiskey he had imbibed, and Will decided it was worth a try to give him a little more rope. Ed Kittredge said he saw right away that Billy was shot from a distance. It doesn't make much sense to think I'd shoot him at a distance, does it? I'd figure it was someone more like you that shot him. But you ain't a good enough shot to hit a man square between the shoulder blades, even at 30 yards like that shot was.
Ha!
Greeley grunted contemptuously.
More like 75 yards.
A dead silence followed immediately as he realized what he had just said. Yeah, Will said calmly. That's about what I made it, 75 yards from that ridge you were hiding on. Rapidly sobering, Greeley took a few steps back.
He's trying to play some kind of game on me, boss. He's a lying son of a bitch. I've been the best deputy to wear this badge for over 8 years. You know I wouldn't do something as bad as what he's saying.
It was a situation that Dan Stone could not imagine he would ever be in, and he was almost at a loss as to how to respond. But clearly, Greeley would have to answer for the outright murder of a prisoner in custody, and it was all caused by his ridiculous envy of Will Tanner's reputation.
I reckon I'm going to have to ask you to hand over your badge and your weapon, Alvin. I'll be damned!
Greeley responded and drew the .44 before either Stone or Will could react.
Ain't nobody arresting me for shooting a no-account little cattle rustler. Now, both of you unbuckle them gun belts real slow and let them drop on the floor. I'm not wearing a gun, Stone said. You're just making it hard on yourself, so hand that gun to me. You're too damn drunk to know what you're doing. He's wearing one,
Greeley said, motioning toward Will.
Drop it, or I swear I'll shoot you both down.
Will didn't doubt that he meant it. He was just irritated that he didn't anticipate Greeley's reaction to be so quick. With no choice now, he slowly unbuckled his gun belt and let it fall to the floor.
Now, go back in that office,
Greeley ordered, and he followed close behind them, his .44 aimed at Will's back. As soon as they stepped inside, he pulled the door shut, picked up Will's gun, and ran for the stairs. At the top step, he paused, anticipating pursuit, and when the door began to open, he fired 3 shots into it. Then he rushed down the steps to the door. Outside, he ran down beside the courthouse, cursing Will Tanner. Inside the office, Stone and Will had dived for cover when Greeley started shooting. Two of the bullets knocked holes in the thin center panel of the door and stuck in the plaster wall behind Stone's desk.
"That son of a bitch has gone crazy," Stone blurted.
"Where's your pistol?" Will exclaimed, and rushed to get it from the desk drawer Dan pointed to.
"I reckon you're going to want me to arrest him now," Will said as he checked the .44 to make sure it was loaded.
"Well, I reckon so,"
Stone drawled, still huddled in the corner behind a leather-covered stuffed chair.
"Figured that," Will said, and crawled up to the door to peep through one of the new bullet holes in the center panel.
After a moment, he reported,
"I can't see much through this hole, but I don't think he's still waiting for us to open the door."
He reached up and took hold of the doorknob, then eased the door open very slowly, for he was sure that Stone was right. Alvin Greeley had gone crazy, and Will was frankly surprised that he hadn't shot both him and the marshal when he had the chance. It was not so unusual that a man would ride on both sides of the law. There were quite a few examples of this over the years, but it usually involved large payrolls or bank shipments too tempting to pass up. Greeley wasn't after money, and now he had dug himself a hole too deep to climb out of.
"He's gone," Will said, when the door was opened far enough to see the entire hallway. "He's on the run, and I need to catch up with him before he has time to clear out. He's on foot, so I'm going to the stable. Maybe I'll catch him there before he gets saddled up."
"You watch yourself,"
Stone exclaimed as Will went out the door. Not certain exactly how crazy Greeley was, he was a little concerned about the possibility of a return visit from him before he got home safely to Mrs. Stone. He wished now that he had asked Will to escort him home before looking for Greeley, at the same time feeling shameful for even thinking about it. Outside the building, Will was relieved to find his two horses still standing at the rail. He climbed on Buster and headed for the stable, thinking that would be the first place Greeley would go. When he reined Buster to a stop, he jumped down and asked,
"Seen Greeley?"
Vern Tuttle met him at the door, having heard the shots.
"Not since you were here a little while ago. What was the shooting about?"
"A little trouble at the courthouse," Will said, and gave him a brief explanation, being in too much a hurry to go into detail. He was puzzled because he figured Greeley would get out of town as quickly as he could. The next place to look would be the Smith House Saloon. Greeley had a room over the saloon and was no doubt still there packing his things. He paused to take a look at Buster, knowing the buckskin had not had ample rest since having just traveled about 25 miles. He wasn't going to be in the best shape to compete with Greeley's gray if it came to a chase.
"I might want to borrow a horse from you if I have to," he said to Vern.
He pulled his saddle off Buster and turned him out with the other horses in the corral, while Vern did the same for Billy Cotton's horse. Then he drew his Winchester from the saddle sling and said,
"I'm going to look for Alvin Greeley. If I miss him and he shows up here, try to stall him as much as you can, but don't go so far as to rile him."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.